The board has just come out of executive session. Is there any action coming out of executive session, board members?
I do have one. I have a motion. Move that the board approve the settlement and release agreement resolving all claims made in Smith versus Oldham County Board of Education, which was filed in the United States District Court for the Western District of Kentucky, civil action number 314-CV87, and authorize the superintendent to take action as necessary to carry out the agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Woosley. May I have a second to that motion, please? Motion was made by Mr. Woosley and seconded by Mr. Shum. All those in favor? All those opposed? That's 3-2. Thank you, Mr. Woosley. Any further action?
I have a second motion. Move that the board declare the board-owned property located at the northeast corner of Veterans Memorial Parkway and the Kenwood Station Elementary School Drive as surplus to the district's educational needs.
Thank you, Mr. Woosley. Motion was made by Mr. Woosley and seconded by Mrs. Beckner. All those in favor? Four. Any opposed? Any abstaining?
No opposed.
That's a 4-1 vote. Thank you. Lastly,
another motion. I move that the board approve the sale of the property located at the northeast corner of Veterans Memorial Parkway and the Kenwood Station Elementary School Drive on the terms set forth in the proposed real estate purchase contract dated March 20th, 2015. Further, move that the board authorize the superintendent to take all actions required to complete the sale, including but not limited to obtaining approval from the Kentucky Department of Education and the execution of the contract, deed, closing statement, and other necessary documents.
All right. Mr. Woosley has offered another motion on the table. Is there a second? Second was made by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor?
We have discussion.
So Mr. Woosley is calling for some discussion. Are there some questions or concerns on this matter?
Yes, Madam Chair. The original letter of intent called out provision allowing for price adjustments based on the usable acreage. After reviewing the plat, which just came into our possession, I have some question as to how that was determined, and I would invite other board members to comment.
Thank you, Mr. Shum. Let me ask the audience if you can hear us okay, if we're miking to the back row. Yes, okay, thank you. Any other questions or concerns on this motion regarding the sale of this property?
I think what we call in question is what's going to be usable. The total property there is 2.3 acres, and there's a survey that says that there's 1.4 acres that's deemed usable. So the concern there is what actually is we consider as usable and what the survey company considers usable.
Does that accurately summarize your concern, Mr. Shum?
Yes, it does accurately. The only thing I would add is that there is a portion of a Indiana Gas Company easement, which most likely would be deemed unusable and unbuildable. My question is for the remaining area of the parcel, and I think Mr. Woosley has accurately described that.
All right. Is there further discussion on this motion? All right, since the motion has been made and seconded, I'm going to call for a vote on the motion that is currently on the table. All those in favor of the sale of this parcel of property, signify by the normal method. Those opposed? All right, that's 4-1 abstention. Any further business?
Yes, Madam Chair, I'd further like to offer an amended motion, and that motion be to authorize the board attorney to look into this matter for us in a timely manner and discover why the potential buyer has deemed part of this parcel, which is unencumbered, unusable.
All right, Mr. Shum, thank you. So the issue on the table is not that we are not willing to continue a further conversation with the interested buyer. The issue is over the terms usable versus non-usable property.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
The price tag for that parcel of property that's usable. Is there a second to Mr. Shum's motion? Second was made by Mrs. Beckner. All those in favor? And that's 5-0. Thank you all very much. Any further action out of executive session? All right, so welcome everybody to Crestwood Elementary and this evening's school board meeting. I want to thank Miss Candace. Where are you? Candace McDaniel, welcome. Thank you for welcoming us. The building looks great. We're anxious to have the showcase with our Crestwood Cougars. So thank you very much. We are going to move at this time. If you all will join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I love, love, love those strong student voices. Welcome, Mrs. McDaniel.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you.
You want to kick off our showcase?
Sure. I will. All right. Be happy to. Welcome to Crestwood Elementary School. We're happy to have you here this evening. I'm going to take the mic off. That may work better. Tonight we have a couple of student showcases that we would like to present to you. And as we were bringing this together, we decided to focus on board goal number one, which is students will be equipped with the understanding, skills, and knowledge necessary for success in life. As part of that board goal, as you are aware, is media and technology, critical thinking and problem solving, communication, creativity and innovation, and leadership. So tonight for our student showcase, you will see a snapshot of how Crestwood is achieving that work goal number one. We're gonna start with Nancy Neville. Nancy Neville is one of our KTIP teachers. I think some of you have been in Ms. Neville's room. She is a fourth grade teacher here at Crestwood Elementary School. This is her first year, and Nancy wanted to start a STEM club. So Nancy, as well as some of her students from her STEM club, are just going to unpack for you a little bit about what they've learned in their STEM club today.
Thank you.
Good evening. I've been very grateful to have the opportunity to lead STEM club this year. We ended up with 32 fourth grade students involved in this brand new club. I'm extremely excited to introduce 5 of my STEM club members to you. They're very excited to explain the engineering design process, which is the process we use for STEM, and they're going to tell you a little bit about what we've been doing in STEM club through that process. So I'm going to introduce Kaylin Weiser.
Hello.
Stephen Embry, Jonah Panette, Isabel Lenz, and Gracie Hale.
Good evening and welcome.
Hello, I'm Ask. Ask is where scientists ask questions like how to build a car that doesn't use fuel. Then they lower it down to something like how to make a car that doesn't or that uses less fuel than all the others. Some of the questions that we had were, what makes a sailboat go? How are sailboats powered? How can you build yours so that it stays afloat? And how can you design a parachute that will maximize air resistance and take longer to land than any other parachute?
Good questions, Kaylin. Stephen.
Hi, I'm Imagine. We use this step to build our knowledge. Also, first, we put down everything that we know about the topic that we're working on. Then we use iPads to research anything else that we don't know about this topic. We now over to Jonah with Plan.
Hello, I am Plan. Plan is basically having a set of ideas for your project. As you can see on the right, there is a visual model of how to build one of the 32 students in STEM Club of their idea of a sailboat. I have one here that was the fastest. We had to travel 33 inches by water in a pool using a fan on medium speed. It was one of the best projects we did. As on the left, we have a lunar module, which we were basing off of Apollo 11. There is one example of one of the designs of one of the students' ideas. And the cool thing about plan is that if you didn't have plan, you would gather your resources needed for the certain project, and you would have, you would say, what am I supposed to, like, it just doesn't make any sense. So, and that is basically plan. Now over to Isabel with the best part, create.
Hi,
you
were
Isabel the best part.
Hi, I'm Isabel, and I'm create. Today, here are some photos of some successful creations that we have done. And here is the most recent one we've done today, dropping an egg off the second floor room into the grass and trying to protect an egg from cracking. And we have an egg in here that hasn't cracked, and creating is my favorite part, in my opinion, and I think it's I think it's most important. But you have to remember not to you have to remember to make a plan before, that way you don't stumble and you don't get confused on what you're doing. Now over to Gracie with improve.
Hi, I'm Gracie and I'm improve. Making improvements is important, but you got to do it right. When you are making improvements, you can only make one improvement at a time. You can only make one improvement because you need to focus on that one improvement. Also, because if you're making more than one improvement at a time and you make a really good improvement and then you make another one that doesn't work, it could prevent your good improvement from working. We, in class, when we were testing our boats, one of the STEM club members was testing those and it didn't work, and then when they were finished, they said, oh, I need a bigger sail. And also when we were doing it, we did a parachute, and the first time it didn't work, and then one of the STEM club members said, oh, we need a bigger source that is lighter so it can maximize air, and so it will reach to the ground slowly. We put together a short video about STEM, where we interviewed students and teachers. Hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you. STEM club shouldn't be everywhere. I think not only STEM club being a school program, but I think that STEM should become part of our everyday academic ability, because I think it's so important. STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And there's so much that we can learn from STEM that goes over into all of the other contents like math and science and even reading. And there's a lot that shows that if you can problem.
Hello, Liz. Why did you join STEM?
Well, I joined STEM because it sounds something like
one,
and I like doing inventions. What
was your favorite part? Pick your favorite activity that we did this competition.
Next, I'm going to turn it over to Kayla Thurman, who is our LMS, and Kayla's just going to give you a short snapshot of how she's working with a couple of students on coding. Kayla?
Ms. McDonald, before we move on, I want to thank our STEM club members for being here and showcasing for us. I have to tell you that they were in the hallway getting ready to come in here when we were going to executive session. I said, oh man, you are the guys that we ask the really hard questions to. So I'm glad you came back to present after I said that, and you all did a fabulous job. Thank you so much.
As she said, I'm Kayla Thurman, and I'm the library media specialist here, and we've started a coding club in the morning with some of our fifth graders. We have about 40 fifth graders involved with this program, and they kind of come in on a rotational basis, so I see each group for about 2 days every week. So these are two of our members of our coding club that wanted to come and share with you a little bit about the computer programming that they've been able to do in the mornings here. So I'm just going to start with Miss Sasha. This is Sasha Hounds, and then this is Luke Levinson with us today. So Sasha, first, can you just tell us, what is coding?
Coding is where you write an algorithm that can be put into a machine, and every time you hit run, it'll do a specific task.
Excellent.
Thank
so
you.
So Luke, why do we need coding? Why is coding important?
It is important because if we didn't have coding, machines wouldn't function. And the phone that's most likely in your pocket, a washing machine and TV wouldn't work.
Excellent. So all those items we use every day, we wouldn't be able to use.
Yeah.
Sasha is going to share with you a little bit about a project that she's been working on. So Sasha, can you share with us about your artist project?
I decided that I like the artist project better than the video game project, and with trial and error, I started drawing circles, and with those circles, I made pizza. Coding takes a while, so I needed patience, and you needed a lot of math for coding because you need to know precision and problem solving and a little bit about the angles and degrees of circles.
Sasha, we have heard people use that term coding over the last year or 2 years, but yours was the best explanation I have ever heard for exactly what coding is. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Are you doing coding in class or as an after school activity?
In the morning, we go down for a wind time, and it's about 8 o'clock, and we work with either Ms. Thurman or Ms. Delling on coding or stock market.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
All right, and as you can see, we were able to get her coding up on the board, and that is drawing her pizza that she created. Luke is also going to share with you, he took a little bit of a different take on his project that he created, so he's going to share with us a little bit about his project.
I was excited about making a video game, but I never realized how hard it was. Now I know that it's extremely hard to make a simple game.
So Luke, can you tell us a little bit about the skills that were involved in making this game?
One of them was problem solving, and I had to figure out how to get him to throw it. And I have one of the things that says when up arrow. It says when move actor one up, and I didn't realize that I had to put the one that made the actor throw the fireball under it too, to make him step and throw at the same time.
Excellent. So, Sasha, how do you feel like these skills are going to transfer into your real life?
They'll help me with problem solving and knowing that in some situations you just have to break the problem down and figure out where it went wrong. Same in coding, you have to break your code down and figure out where your code went wrong.
And Luke, how do you feel like this is going to help you prepare for your future career?
I want to go into engineering, and it's going to help me with problem solving in mathematics and in organization.
Excellent. And now Sasha has an invitation she wants to extend to you.
Our school and the fourth grade STEM club would love to have you at STEM Fest on April 23rd from 5:30 p.m. to 8 o'clock p.m.
Okay, Sasha, I'm going to write that down, that date, Sasha and Luke, as long as you don't make me participate. If I can just come and watch our students participate, I will be there. Thank you, Luke.
Luke, what grade are you in?
Fourth. Thank you.
Fifth.
Thank you.
Good job.
And thank you guys very much.
We just have one last thing that we'd like to present, and this is actually to our retirees. So our chorus, Crestwood Chorus, led by Matt Lunn, our music teacher, is going to sing a tribute to all of our administrative retirees. He's going to sing, or the chorus is going to sing, For Good from the Broadway musical Wicked. And this is to Anita Davis, Chief Academic Officer, Dan Orman, Assistant Superintendent, Carol Huey, retired principal from preschool, Lisa Cheek, who's retiring from Buckner, Jane Smith, Liberty Elementary, and Jim Ross, East Oldham Middle School. Because we knew you, we have all been changed for good.
Oh, very nice.
Madam Chairperson, this concludes our student showcase.
Thank you, Ms. McDonald. Donald, whatever. I can only get away with that because I've known Ms. Candace for many years. I think you all would agree with me that we have all been changed by the better as a result of this student showcase. So thank you, Crestwood Cougars. I usually give families an opportunity to make a graceful exit at this time, unless you'd like to stay for the rest of this exciting meeting.
Okay, we have a couple of recognitions here. First, we have three students who are on the swim team at North Oldham High School. You three, if you are here, would you please come forward? Come on up. Four? You're right, four. Just testing you. Come on up, you four. I'll meet you over here. All right, face the crowd if you would please. Let me tell everyone about these four students. North Oldham High School's girls swim team. First is are the coaches here. Yeah. Coaches, come forward. Come on down, coaches. North Oldham High School's girls swim team earned three top three finishes at the state championship. They are Grace Oglesby, raise your hand. Receive your certificate, Grace Oglesby. Emma Bazo? Brazo. There's no R. Lily Oglesby? That's Lily. And Kelly Tishner. Grace, raise your hand again, Grace. She won two state titles at the state championship with first place finishes in the 50-yard freestyle and the 100-yard butterfly. Grace was also part of a third-place 200-yard medley team with teammates Emma, Lily, and Kelly. All three of these results were automatic All-American times. Congratulations to these girls and their accomplishments, and thanks to their coach, Chris Crone, and then who's with us tonight, Randy Shearer. Congratulations. All right, you all can have a seat. Thank you all very much. Now, we have some wrestling students from Oldham County High School and North Oldham High School. Would you all please come forward? And coaches, if you're here, would you also please join them? We'd like to recognize these wrestlers from Oldham County High School and North Oldham High School. We have Alex McIntosh, please raise your hand. Brady Emerson, Max Emerson, and Landon Jones.
let me tell you one about your accomplishments recently. Oldham County High School's Alex McIntosh. Where's Alex? Raise your hand again. He earned a state championship at the state meet in the 170-pound class. Teammates, there you go. Congratulations. Brady Emerson, raise your hand again. And Max Emerson, yes, they are twins. Sons of Steve and Chandra, who are here, teachers of ours. There we go. Principal and teacher. They earned third place titles at the state level. Brady in the 138-pound class and Max in the 160-pound class. The Oldham County High School wrestling team placed fifth overall. Way to go, OC. We'd also like to recognize Oldham County High School coach Aaron Reardon, who's also here. Thank you for coming. Congratulations. And Landon Jones is here from North Oldham High School. He placed second in the state at the 285-pound class, and he was part of a North Oldham High School team that placed 10th overall. Great job, Landon. And we're proud to have North Oldham High School coach Tony Zeppa here with us this evening as well. So I'd like to say congratulations on behalf of the board to the Oldham County High School and North Oldham High School wrestling team and the swimmers from North Oldham High School. We know how much time and effort it takes to participate in extracurricular activities and hold the grades to the standard that you do, and coaches, the time that you all put in as well. Thank you all very much and congratulations.
Agenda, and we are ready for superintendent report number one, sir.
Mr. Ewalt is here with some construction project updates.
Good evening.
Well, good evening. Okay, for this evening's construction report, I want to begin with our district-wide safety and security upgrades. Since my last report of last month, the project is still moving forward, but not quite at the rate that I would prefer due to some weather delays with meetings and this sort of thing. But our interview process was finally completed with the integrators. The integrators are currently visiting schools in preparation for their request for proposal. The finalization of the construction documents has slipped and has not been submitted to KDE yet, like I had anticipated, but we were doing some additional review of the plans due to some budgetary concerns we had, and Dr. Wells and I reviewed, for example, all the camera locations at each of the locations and deferred some of the cameras to a future phase. We are still, however, anticipating the advertisement to take place in May for this project. Actual construction will still take place in the four groups, as I mentioned last time, and with the first group starting in June, and then proceeding with each group after that, as we discussed. The next project is the Oldham County Middle School Phase 2 renovation. Punch inspections are still taking place so that Morrell Construction can work on outstanding issues during the spring break. We're still experiencing some issues with temperature control systems, but not to the extent that the occupancies are you know, being uncomfortable in the space, but we're still trying to work through these bugs in the system. Our South Oldham Middle School project, pre-construction and progress meetings have taken place since our last meeting, and Park Oak Constructors has moved the job trailer on site. Shop drawings are being processed for the project, and layout work is scheduled to take place for the superstructure during spring break. In addition, Arvin Education Center, the bids were received, and of course they're on the agenda for this evening for consideration, as is the Oldham County High School new emergency generator. And those bids were also received on Thursday and are on the agenda for this evening. And the last project that we're still continuing to design on is our leak repairs for 2015. Barney McCullough and Paul Murray and I have visited some of the schools in order to tie down the scope of work, and we've got a preliminary schedule, and I didn't bring that with me, but in hopes of getting that on the up to KDE and then on the street very soon.
Good. Excellent. Questions or comments for Mr. Ewald?
Hopefully we have all the bad weather out of the way. Do you feel like we're going to be where we need to be by the time spring break rolls around and then the time the summer construction projects start? We're going to be delayed in it. Do you think we're back on target?
Well, on our South Middle project specifically, that had a major impact on it. They have contractors not indicated that the delay is, you know, caused any insurmountable problems with the overall schedule. But you know, we're still at the beginning point of this, and as soon as we start getting the layout completed, know if there's any conflicts with the plans and the actual building construction, then that we'll be able to formalize a better plan.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? Thank you, Mr. Ewald.
Okay.
Superintendent, report number two, please.
There are some policy revisions that are there in your agenda. Ms. Forson has prepared that enclosure. I'll give you a brief overview.
All right. Welcome, Ms. Forson.
Hello. These are four changes that you have to policies that you haven't seen before. They will be back next month for approval. The first one sets a deadline on school allocations as far as when they have to be committed or used before it reverts back to the board. The second one has to do with discipline information of employees. This has been our practice as far as making statements that could be used both for a disciplinary and in a criminal investigation, but we're making it part of our policy because it's not actually written anywhere. And under the employee leave policy, it's been recommended that we change this to allow only tenured teachers to be on contracts with the Kentucky Department of Education. Typically, they can be gone for up to 3 years, so we feel like maybe they should be tenured before they leave us to go and then come back. And then it would also extends the time to a 3-year time period. The law allows for 2 years with subsequent renewal, but KDE often wants a 3-year memorandum of agreement. So our policy would allow teachers to be out for up to 3 years without having to renew it. And finally, under the Family Medical Leave Act, we are changing our calculation of the 12-month period in which you can take leave. We've kind of been doing it on a forward-looking basis, but our policy says we'll do it on a rolling basis, and that's just a very complicated way to calculate the 12-month period. So with as many employees as we have going on leave, the forward-looking calculation is much simpler for the personnel department to implement. Do you have any questions on these changes?
Questions or comments, Mr. Woosley?
I have one, Ms. Corson. On 50-50, when we're talking about professional leave and they're tenured, are we requiring them to be tenured before they start that leave, or they can't get, like, their ninth year, get tenured and then stay out 2 and 3?
Right. I mean, the intent behind the policy change is that they would have their tenure before they leave, because currently we do have some teachers that are not tenured, and as long as they're on this MOU, they are actually getting their tenure while they're at KDE, even though they haven't been in a classroom for 1 to 3 years. So this would allow them to get their tenure here first before they go to the state.
Will this affect those that are already there on leave?
No, it'll just start July 1st going forward.
The question that occurs to me, Ms. Corson, these policies all affect our staff. And so what I'd like to know is a reminder of how we make our staff aware that we are discussing these policy changes.
We like to surprise them.
That's what I was afraid you'd say.
No, I'm just kidding. If there's some significant policy that's going to affect them, we put it out as part of our administrative packets that we do to alert them of any significant changes.
Thank you. And so board members would also welcome any kind of input that staff would have for us regarding these policy changes. The one, the flex funding that will need to be used before April 15th, what? Remind me what the deadline used to be or what the parameters were of that.
It used to say the end of the year, which could take it all the way to our end of our fiscal year, which is July, and before that money was swept back into the district's general funds. So now if they're not used or committed by April 15th, they will be put back into the board's demo fund. So that in itself seems to me to be fairly significant for our schools. So,
yes. All right. Principals will get notice of that one because they're going to be affected most by it.
Yeah. All right. Other questions or comments? All right. We will see these next month on our in our action items. Great. Thank you, Ms. Corson.
You're welcome.
All right, Superintendent, report number three, sir.
I've prepared the board members to share out their KSBA conference. I've prepared for them. You all requested to share out from your KSBA attendance some valuable conferences or sessions. You all have your opportunity to discuss them.
Yes, thank you, Superintendent. Board members do attend various conferences throughout the year, and I'm not sure that we've done a very good job making our staff aware of what we do in between board meetings. And we are required by the state to attain a certain number of CEUs based on our longevity in our positions. For instance, it has to do with tenure, but for instance, I think Ms. Beckner is still required to attain 12 hours of CEU, if you want to use that term, per year, and that's the maximum. And it goes down to 4 hours per year, which is what I am required to attain. Now, having said that, they also have various levels of leadership built into the system, varying from level one to level five leadership. And those levels require many more hours with much more diversified material. And so we work towards those levels of leadership. And I will not share with you what level we are all at. We are all at different levels. I achieved my level five leadership several years ago. But at any rate, we also do a very good job reporting back to you the fact that we did just not too long ago attend the KSBA winter spring symposium, and they provide three major conferences throughout the year. There's a winter symposium, then there is a spring and summer leadership. So there are lots of opportunities. And then there's also an annual national conference, which most of us attended with the superintendent just this last week, which was in Nashville, Tennessee. And we actually concurred that we gained more out of the experience at our own Kentucky conference. It's a great opportunity for us to sort of get a barometer or barometric reading based on how we are doing as board members compared to others around the state and around the country, and also what our district is doing by comparison. There are three requirements that Kentucky made mandatory for each of us to attend each year, and those include a session on ethics, a session on superintendent evaluation, and a session on finance. So we each now attend sessions on those annually. And we have attended a variety of sessions at this most recent Kentucky School Board Association, and really board members said, we'd like to share some of the exciting things that we think we benefited from. So I'm going to ask whoever wants to lead with that. I will tell you that I was dealing with this shoulder injury at the time, and so missed most of the conference except for two sessions. One was on the superintendency. Are you falling asleep? Really? Superintendent evaluation system. And as you know, we are in the throes of revising the superintendent evaluation process, just as you all have been dealing with PGES. And we are required to implement that next year. And the other session I attended was regarding ethics. I'm going to let one of the board members talk now for several minutes. Mr. Woosley.
I think your explanation was almost as long as the conference.
Okay. we're going to have to put into place a session on respect, I think. I think I'm going to have to make that mandatory.
Follow their ethics.
We all attended
some of us attended the same class. Most of us attended different classes while we were there. We were able to spend a little bit of time with some vendors that we used throughout the state. I took away a couple of things that, well, first of all, Oldham County is doing great compared to the state from what we're hearing out in the other districts. We've got some really exciting things going on here that other districts aren't using. We picked up some stuff that they're using that we'd like to bring back here. But I wish Mr. Stewart was here. I saw that he just left, so Ms. Nyhoff, this is going to be on you. One of my sessions was on propane buses. This is fairly new to Kentucky. We, of course, use all diesel here. Crittenden County was the pilot program on some propane buses. It's worked out very well there, and this is the first year that Kentucky has now allowed other districts to move into that realm. We found out there's about $10,000 difference cheaper on propane buses versus diesel buses. That's just in the cost of it. And that's out the door cost, just like we would buy a regular diesel bus. There's also other additional added benefits, including there's no electricity cost in the winter to heat them, which is probably $1,000 a month for Oldham County. The maintenance on those buses are cheaper. They burn hotter, so they're cleaner. There's a much quicker time in heating up in the winter, so you're not having to start them earlier. And the cost of propane is a lot cheaper than we're finding for diesel fuel. I know that we looked at this a couple of years ago, and it didn't look like then it was going to be cost-worthy for us. Trimble County has ordered one bus, and it's supposed to be in soon. So it's something I think we probably need to look at. If we bought 13 buses, which we did this year, I think we could have saved the cost on one of them just by buying those propane buses. Trimble County's got worked out a deal with a vendor that they're actually coming up, setting the whole tank up for them, the pump and everything. So it may be something to save us some money down the road and have a higher quality bus. The second one, Mr. Ewald, was on temporary buildings. I know that's something that we've never really looked at. We've got some programs that are exploding here in Oldham County, one of them being the Arvin Center, and we've talked about different ways of how we're going to maintain that as we can get a building going. When we think of temporary buildings, we think of modular trailers. That, I think, has grown into a different look. So I've got some information for you that other districts are using that could house the Arvin Center for a few years. And it's something that we can keep and use it at other programs if we needed to later on. It's about $300,000 for a 30 by 60.
68.
On our property that we'd already have to have hooked up. So it's just a different look, but it may be something that we could obtain and use while we're growing a program into a requirement for a full building. That was my takeaway of the conference.
Thank you, Mr. Woosley. Mr. Dodson?
Well, as everyone knows in here, I'm heavy with Frankfort. And they had a legislative session with David Gibbons, one of the House reps, and one of the state senators, and I can't think of his name right now. And one of the questions were asked, and I will say I ask it. I asked him, I said, y'all talk a lot about full-day kindergarten, full-day preschool. Why aren't you funding it? And the answer I got from them totally startled me. There's only 5 or 6 districts in the state that doesn't have full-day kindergarten. He said, y'all are already funding it. Why should we worry about it? Which I thought was kind of arrogant on my part on what I got from it. And I said, you know, we could take that extra money and put to other programs to affect other kids if y'all would fund it. We also talked to them. I also asked them about the SEEK formula. Why haven't they adjusted it? They've talked about it, but they say they never get to it. Well, it's time they get off the stick and get to it. And another question was asked to them, unfunded mandates. Teachers got raises this year and they were well deserved. But what happened with us, the state didn't fund it. They cut us short a lot of money. And we told them, if you want to put something on us, as school systems, we do not mind doing anything. but fund it. Don't put it back to the individual school systems. And we sort of got back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. But what totally amazed me is their attitude towards not funding full day kindergarten. Totally blew me away. And then I discussed with them later, I said, y'all are wrong with what you're doing. These kids deserve it. What about those five or six county districts that can't afford it? Now those kids are left behind. But basically what I got out of that session is, Frankfort's not gonna do anything. It's all about being reelected up there in Frankfort. And because some of them was getting ready to run again. And I told them that, I'm very blunt about it, but that's the way I feel about Frankfort. So keep writing these people. The second session I attended, it wasn't really a training session. It was more of a motivational session. But I'm not much on keynote speakers. And some of these board members will tell you, it's all I've talked about since I attended, even at work. I'm trying to get this guy into our work. He was a character in the movie Freedom Riders. I don't know if any of y'all ever saw it. His name is Manny Scott. And he talked about things with teachers that we are doing here in Oldham County. And it's things that maybe we need to look at a little more. He said, teachers know why they have to teach. And he had a teacher fresh out of college the first year. She was a cheerleader. She comes in class. And she knew why, but she didn't know the how. And she studied her class, and they kept trying to make it so hard on her she couldn't get out. And she studied, and she finally figured out the how, because one of the things he mentioned to me, he said they wanted us to read literature about a bunch of old guys wearing white tights and all this old literature. And she came in one day, and she had a poem or something. She put it out in a poem. It says by one of her favorite artists, Calvin Corzal Broadus. And they got into it, and they really got into it. And they asked, and she asked him, have y'all ever heard this? Do you know this guy? They said, no, that's Snoop Dogg. Right then she had him. Right then she had him. And she took her class, and out of the 4 years they were in that school, there was doctors, lawyers, everybody came out of that class. One of the most rambunctious kids to try to get rid of the teachers was the teacher of the year at that school last year. But it's the little things that we've got to apply on our kids. He said one day he was in school and a resource officer told him to pull up his pants. And he said, they noticed me because he had no family. He was living on the streets. And a little old lunchroom lady grabbed his cheeks and said, there's going to be great things out of you. Right now, he's got his own jet. He'll be getting his doctorate's degree in a couple of years, all because this one teacher said, hey, you've got great things in you, and the whole group ended up graduating. So what I'm trying to say is we need to look at the little things, just a hi, how you doing? Because he remember one teacher told him out of class, said, you stink. You need to wash your clothes. Kid was living on the streets, had no place to wash his clothes. So we got to look at what we don't see in school. We got to look at these kids that may not have a high at home and make it a point to know some at school. And that's what got me, is that we need to get more into the how instead of the why, because we know why we got to do it. We just got to find the right hows. And if you ever get a chance to Google Manny Scott, Google him and listen to some of his talks. He's amazing.
I went to the New Opportunities for Local Board to promote school readiness, so I don't have anything that I can tell these educators that they don't already know, but it was exciting, and the presenter was the executive director of the Governor's Office of Early Childhood, and when she saw that I was from Oldham County, she made a point to be very complimentary of our preschool, and so I wanted to make sure that the preschool staff knew that she sang their praises a couple of times, actually. what I took away from it was more for us as a board. I'd like for us to really focus on this and see the urgency of what we now see with the Brigance data. And I know I've said this before, so I'm going to take my soapbox moment and say that I would like for us to have a plan, put some verbs in our sentences, and grow this program. I don't know how that we could do. I like to see something put forward to us like the engineering program was, where we can see the Cadillac version all the way down so we can try and find the funding and make it happen and actually move on it. Some of the things that they talked about for some of the districts that didn't have a preschool that we could consider in the meantime would be they were partnering with the private sector childcare. They mentioned that Christian County was actually paying for a certified teacher to go into the private sector, and it was cheaper for them because they didn't have to pay for buses and overhead of the building. And so that was a way that they found to make it more cost effective for them. And also the early childhood profiles. Every district has one, and I pulled up Oldham County's, and it reflects much of what Ms. Cordray and Dr. Wells and Ms. Davis has told us. What I did know was, just like we get the data about Oldham County's preschool students, how ready they were for kindergarten, it is broke down to each individual childcare facility, and it's provided to our district. And she encouraged that the district reach out to those agencies, let them know how their kids are testing on that Brigance data, and it's not to be made public, but to have those conversations. So I would urge our district to have those conversations and to reach out and see how we can help them get those kids ready. And also one of the suggestions to help them was to involve them in our trainings. And I know Ms. Cordray had talked something about that with our childhood community council. So I just basically charge it to the board. We know it's important, so I want us to act on it.
We do. Thank you, Ms. Beckner. So we appreciate the opportunity to share some of our highlights from our recent training experiences. And I think what I really want you to take away from this superintendent report is the fact that these are your elected school board members who are not being paid to receive trainings, but they go enthusiastically and give up their free time to participate in trainings way above what's required. So thank you, everybody, for being that dedicated to the students of Oldham County. Thank you, Superintendent. We are ready for action item F.
Yes, this is the information, I believe, that was shared with you at last month's meeting regarding the 2015-16 school calendar and major breakup dates for the 16-17 school year. This is coming to you as a recommendation from the calendar committee. Mr. Dodson, I believe, is your representative on the calendar committee.
Yes.
So Michael's here to answer any questions you might have. If not, then it's there for your review, and you have a recommendation.
All right, we have looked at this before. Board members, questions or comments? Mr. Williams, before we take action on this calendar, I would just like to make sure that we remind our community of the fact that we do indeed build in 12 snow days into this calendar. And we hear this concern year after year as the school year gets supposedly prolonged. In reality, it does not. In reality, the school year calendar ends at the end of those designated snow days, which may run until June 13th or June 12th. And so I would also like to remind our community that it is not a good idea to schedule vacations, et cetera, beyond what you see as the hopeful last day of school. That has not happened the last couple of years, and frequently does not happen. We frequently do not get out of school on the June 2nd or June 3rd date. We frequently have snow days. And so the last significant day that we could be in school is that projected end of those snow days, and could very well go beyond that. But we do indeed have snow days built into our calendar.
Correct. We are required by state law to list the maximum number over the last 5 years that we have missed in any given year. So at this point, with this new calendar, because we missed 12 days last year in this new calendar for 15-16, we have to list those 12 makeup days. Up to this point, we've been at 10, because that's how many we had missed prior to that.
Right. Good point. Thank you. So other questions or concerns? All right. Your recommendation, Superintendent?
Do you approve those dates?
All right. Motion to approve this item made by Mr. Shum, seconded by Mrs. Beckner. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Thank you, Mr. Williams, and thank you, Calendar Committee. Those of you that served on the Calendar Committee, thank you. Action item G, sir.
At last month's meeting, you received a report from Ms. Nyhoff and the committee that she used, where every school was represented with their library media specialist and teachers, administrators, librarians were able to make recommendations regarding how they would like to see their classroom technology evolve in the next few years. And so that was shared as a superintendent report. Now it's before you as an action item to be included in this year's budget. And when we have a working session on April the 13th, that's where we will dig into the budget a little deeper and look at all of the requests for next year's budget. And this would put that among those list of initiatives and proposals for you all to consider when you adopt the budget in May.
So we have also seen this proposal several times probably as it evolves. Are there questions or comments at this time?
Ms. Lewis. Since we're going to have a work session on the budget, which is going to explain to us how we're going to fund this, can we table this until we have that discussion with the budget? I'm not feel comfortable with approving it now, not knowing how we're going to pay for it until we have that work session.
Sure. That's fine.
That work session is April 13th, Ms. Nyhoff, so we shouldn't lose too much time. Do other board members feel the same concern? We don't have any figures here to operate off of. Superintendent?
We can. This would include it, or we can include it in the discussion next month anyway. If you don't adopt it at this time, it'll be included in there so you can see the big picture. The figures were assumed in this proposal or what you were
exactly
in last month's meeting. But we can add it as part of the discussion where you can see the revenue and the expenditures all at the same time, April 13th meeting.
I think the fact that the recommendation doesn't include that information again for board members to have in front of them, it is the sticky wicket here. So we can also take action April 13th. We will all be there. So we will table this, Ms. Dial. Thank you, Mr. Woosley. Action item. No. Action item H.
High school graduation dates for 2015 are included in this recommendation. You can see the location and the dates and times for high school graduation.
We did not have this information last month, although this is on as an action item, of course. So do you have questions or concerns? Superintendent, you want to review the recommendation, please, sir?
Yes, we always have Buckner Alternatives graduation the night before the other high school graduations, and so that would be June the 12th at the Oldham County Schools Arts Center at 7 p.m. And Saturday, June 13th, we would have South Oldham High School at 11 o'clock, Oldham County High School at 2:30 p.m., North Oldham High School at 6 p.m., and all those would be at Broadbent Arena.
All right, thank you. Questions? Concerns?
We got an email with one concern on that date, that the 13th is also the ACT testing date. You responded back to that, but do you want to explain that again?
Yeah, if you'd like, sure. That is one of the ACT testing dates, and that would only affect South Oldham High School since they graduate at 11. It would not affect students at Oldham County or North Oldham High School. And the guidance office at South Oldham High School advised that there would be very few students, none of whom are seniors, that would be involved in the ACT testing that day that they were aware of or should be aware of.
Other questions? All right, your recommendation, Superintendent?
That you approve.
Motion to approve, please, made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Mr. Shum. All those in favor, that's 5-0. Superintendent, action item I, please.
You have a fee waiver request being submitted by the Art Center because of the Oldham County Community Scholarship organization would like to use that facility for their events this spring to grant students their scholarships.
Comments, questions? Motion to approve. Your recommendation, Superintendent?
You approve.
Motion to approve made by Ms. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Shum. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Action item J.
That is our recommendation for you to approve the auditor for actually the contract for fiscal 15 is there for you to review.
Questions or comments?
Yes.
Mr. Dodson.
I know we talked at one time about changing them, but I think it was on a, what, a three-year rotation or a two-year rotation? This will be the second year with this one, but
correct.
Will next year we be looking at another one?
We can make that decision from year to year.
Okay.
So, your recommendation, sir?
Do you approve?
Motion to approve the auditor made by Ms. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor, and that's 5-0. Thank you all. Action item K, please.
There's been a lot of discussion about Senate Bill 119 and how that would affect Oldham County if the board wanted to take advantage of that legislation to make any changes to the school year calendar. And so we have, I think, kept in pretty good and close communication with the board about all the options, and we've asked for feedback from principals and teachers and so on. And so the information has been presented to you and for you to discuss. I do have a recommendation that you're ready for that.
All right, thank you for joining us, Mr. Williams. We have seen this information, so it is not new to us. Are there questions or comments?
Can we hear the superintendent's recommendation?
We can.
I would recommend we make no changes to the calendar, considering the various options here. The concerns regarding the financial impact of all those options and starting the elementary day earlier just does not seem to be worth the time and trouble to basically reduce our calendar year by 1 to 4 student contact days. And so I would recommend that we leave the calendar as is based on the calendar that was submitted and approved by the board. Where our last day of school for students would be June 12th, as is.
Do we still have an option if something happens, a big storm rolls through, or we can make up one day, correct me if I'm wrong. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the provisions allowed in Senate Bill 119 exist for the rest of this year. So if something unforeseen were to still happen, then yes, the board could come back and make those modifications.
I think my major concern with it is we already have young kiddos that get on the bus at 6:45, and we ask, if we start 30 minutes early, we're gonna ask them to get on the bus at 6:15. I just think that's unreasonable.
I think your opinion was agreed to by a lot of other elementary folk.
Yeah, I agree. Other questions, comments? All right, your recommendation, sir, once again?
That we keep the calendar for the 2014-15 school year as is, according to the calendar that was adopted by the board previously.
All right. Motion to approve, made by Mr. Shum, seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in discussion. Further discussion, Mr. Woosley?
I have a question about the 2014 calendar.
Okay.
November 17th.
We should continue voting on this.
That's a different issue. Yeah. Woosley. All right.
Afterwards, I need to talk to you about the calendar.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
All right, the motion's on the floor. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Williams later. All right, action item L, sir.
The approval of the capital funds request is there for your review.
Questions or comments, board members? Your recommendation, Superintendent?
Do you approve that capital funds request?
Motion to approve, please. Made by Mrs. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Action item M, sir.
This is a contract for the emergency generator project for this summer at Allen County High School.
Questions or comments? Motion to approve at Dr. Wells' recommendation. Mr. Dodson made the motion. Mr. Shum, did you second it?
Yes, I
all
did,
those
ma'am.
In favor? And that's 5-0. Thank you. Superintendent, action item N, sir.
This is another contract that we'd like to award to work on the fire alarm and intercom upgrade project at the Arbor Center.
All right. Discussion? Your recommendation, sir?
Did you approve that contract?
Motion to approve, made by Mrs. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Woosley. All those in favor? And that's 5-0. Action item O, sir.
This is a shortened school day request for a North Oldham middle school student. That just came in, so we'd like to ask you to approve that.
All right. Discussion? Your recommendation?
That you approve?
Motion to approve, please, made by Mr. Dodson, seconded by Mrs. Beckner. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you. And last but not least, action item P.
It's a second approval that we've received for a short school day for a North Oldham High School student.
All right, discussion, recommendation, sir?
Do you approve?
Motion to approve, made by Mr. Woosley, seconded by Mr. Shum. All those in favor? And that's 5-0. We are ready, Mr. Williams, for monthly public expression, sir.
Speakers are registered by signing the sign-in sheet as they arrive at the meeting to provide for first come, first speak. Expressions are limited to not more than the time allotted by the board based on the number of persons who wish to make an expression. Public criticism of individual staff members and individual board members is prohibited. Concerns about individual staff performance are to be addressed to the staff member or his or her immediate superior or the board chair respectively. Public expression is not a question and answer period. Speakers who express questions will have the question noted with follow-up by appropriate board staff. However, the board reserves the right to respond when appropriate or necessary.
Thank you, Mr. Woosley. So we have two persons wishing to address the board, and the first is Mr. Tom McShane.
I was the first to sign up.
Hello, welcome.
Hello. Some of you know me, some of you know of me. Mm-hmm. This is my daughter, 10-year-old daughter. She happens to go to this school. So I heard there was a board meeting here, and just down the street, so I thought I'd just pop in. My name is Tom McShane, and I have five kids enrolled in Oldham County Schools. I'm also a musician, and I also own the local music shop. Last week, I had a wonderful opportunity to, on early release day to meet with the elementary school music teachers, and I was really impressed at just a wonderful bunch of excited and motivated teachers and just looking for ways that they can get music education into our children. And as we just fellowship. We shared the common experience of knowing firsthand how important music education is in our schools and how it complements every other area of study. And of course, we knew that. So I want to encourage the school administration, the teachers and parents to continue to seek out innovative ways to get music education into our schools. It thrills me to see teachers like Mr. Albertan of Harmony Elementary spearheading ukulele programs for the kids, or Ms. Meyer of Kenwood Elementary bringing the dulcimer in her class as the official Kentucky State instrument, musical instrument. So, as a bus driver, because I am also an Oldham County School bus driver, I started to see for the first time this year kids riding to school with violins in their hands, thanks to the efforts of the Oldham Arts Center, bringing string instruction to some of the school locations. And I would like to see that continue in all the schools, really, because when I was their age, I had to go into the neighboring county to get my string education. So. I have a particular burden because I live here and I have children here, but that would continue to be nurtured. And I also have school students of all levels frequent my music shop. We're also taking guitar classes at the school. Now, the advantage I have, having the local candy store, so to speak, is that I get to hear from students, I get to hear from parents, I get to hear from teachers, I get to hear from the local music musicians, I also get to hear from national musicians. So I have a pretty good collective pulse sometimes of what's going on in the scene, the local scene, which is developing here in this county. So the band program in our schools, as we all know it, at the upper levels, has always been going strong since the mid-70s when I attended Oakland County Schools and was in the band. However, progress in our schools is measured by the variety of resources and options that are made available. So I am proud to have a business that's growing right along with my community, and I'm looking forward to being of service to all the local schools for any of and all of your musical needs. And that's all I have to share.
Thank you. Nice to meet you both. Oh,
she was dying to say something.
Well, I kind of want to compliment my school because I kind of admire them for letting the students not only learn from the teachers, but the teachers learn from the students. And that they try to really make learning fun, and it is.
All right, thank you. Thank you both. Thank you, Mr. McShane. The next person wishing to address us is Mr. Dudley Thompson. Welcome, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you. Good evening, board.
Good evening.
I'm here with the South Oakland Lions Club. June the 27th, we have our Crestwood Festival here at this location at Crestwood Elementary. And I'm here seeking y'all's permission to renew for our gaming activity that we have for the festival. And this has been done each year. If I may pass this out to you. This is a restriction card. First, I'd like to say that, first of all, if you're not familiar with the Lions Club, that we are a nonprofit organization. And secondly, if you glance at the second page, you'll see some of the things that we do with the money, the donations that we, and programs that we support here in Oldham County. And probably the number one thing is that the pre-testing of, or testing of the preschool kids. And here in the last 2 years, we've tested for their vision over 2,000 children at no cost to any of the parents or anyone. So here again, we would are asking for the approval of the board to be able to offer our gaming activity, which is a 50-50 raffle on June the 27th.
Thank you, Mr. Thompson.
Any questions?
Are there questions, comments, board members? We have supported this activity in years past. Correct me if I am wrong. Did you not hold your event on the South Oldham, South High campus?
Correct, last year.
Last year, so mm-hmm. Now
this
you,
year
you are moving
here
it
at this
here.
Location.
Right. All right, mm-hmm. Just point of clarification. Superintendent, what's your recommendation on this? We can take action on this item if you'd like.
We need to follow through with all the paperwork, make sure all those I's are dotted, T's are crossed with the organization, with insurance and all those details. But if the board would like to have a recommendation, we approve it.
This is actually public expression, but do we have any concerns for waiting to take action on this?
Madam Chair, my concern is that promoting any activity of raffling or gambling on school property is inappropriate. Therefore, I would recommend against it, even though I believe in what the Lions Club has been doing.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Shum. I'm just thinking out loud as to whether or not we need to have further discussion on this, Superintendent. I will let you and General Counsel have a conversation, and we will take your report under advisement, Mr. Thompson. Superintendent Wells will be back in touch with you. All right. Thank you. All right. We are at the end of the agenda. And I want to remind board members to read both of the information items at the end of this agenda. One is the report from the preschool and Head Start program, and the second is the district energy usage. Your recommendation, sir?
We adjourn.
Motion to adjourn, made by Mrs. Beckner, seconded by Mr. Dodson. All those in favor, 5-0. Safe travels home.